Hi, it's Kathy, Nikki's online business manager. I'm popping in here before the podcast starts to share that the 2022 MasterPass is now available at a super special price. The MasterPass gets you access to all 5 masterclasses Nikki is teaching next year. Each masterclass is taught over a 3-week time period, 2 hours each week. Dates and class descriptions can be found at yoursalesmaven.com. With each class, you'll receive a workbook packed full of value to support your learning, plus get access to the class recordings in case you miss a class. Sign up now, and instead of paying almost $4,000 for the classes, the Master Pass is only $1,995. That's a 50% savings off of each class. It's super easy to register. Go to yoursalesmaven.com/2022MasterPass. Nikki even included a simple payment plan in case that's easier for you, so go check it out. Pay now in 2021 and you'll be set for sales training all through 2022. This offer is only available through December 17th. So go grab your MasterPass now at yoursalesmaven.com/2022MasterPass. Now, here comes Nikki to start the show.
Are you ready to boost your confidence when selling so you're able to close more deals? Nikki Rausch will show you how to build a foundation of skills and a mindset that creates sales success without feeling pushy or salesy and without fear of rejection. She is a sales strategist and coach with more than 25 years of sales experience and is master certified in neuro-linguistic programming. This is a radically different approach to selling. It's a no sleaze, no slime, and no stress approach to building your business. This is Sales Maven. Here's Nikki. Welcome, and thank you for listening to the Sales Maven Show. I'm your host, Nikki Rausch. I'm your own personal sales maven, here to offer you tips, techniques, and strategies to master your sales conversations. Today's episode is all about turning failures into business opportunities. So we're going to talk about failures today. Specifically mine. And the objective, hopefully, is that when you listen to this episode, hopefully it'll give you some ideas of one, how to handle these types of situations that come up in business, because for all of us, they do. And also to really get clear on what do you do with your mindset in these particular situations. So before I jump into the content, I'm going to ask a little favor, if I may. Would you please rate, review, and or share the podcast with somebody you know that would benefit from it? Your ratings and reviews help people find the podcast, take a chance on listening. You sharing the podcast with somebody is probably the best way for somebody to be willing to, okay, maybe I'll check out an episode or not, or two, we'll see. But if you'd be willing to do that for me, I would be so grateful. Thank you so much for those of you who have done this. It means the world to me. I find your reviews specifically to be just, they like touch that tender place in my heart. The fact that you take the time to share about it. So thank you for that. All right, so I want to get into this topic. And the reason that I'm recording this particular podcast, it wasn't on my list of things to talk about, but I was asked to sit on a panel recently and a question got asked of the panel and we weren't prepared ahead of time. We didn't have the questions. We didn't know what we were going to be asked. And it was a panel that had to do with mindset. And so I think it was, I can't remember exactly how the question was phrased, but it was essentially of like, what's an example of a failure that you've had in your business? And what did you learn from that? And how did you combat that? Or how did you kind of push through it? And the person who asked the question, she shared first. And it was because of what she shared that reminded me of one of my big failures when I first started my business. And I don't know that I've ever told this story to me. I maybe have shared this story to 2 people total in my life. Because when it happened, there was a lot of shame around it. Now, since then, I've moved past it, and I'm going to talk about the ways that I now handle these types of situations. But at the time, I was so embarrassed and so filled with shame that I didn't talk about it. And then, you know, over time, with anything, like time heals all, right? So I was able to, honestly, for I haven't thought of it in years. But because of this question, it came up. And then I started thinking, I wonder if this would be helpful to share on the podcast. So that's why I'm sharing it with you today. And I actually have a couple stories to share with you today, but one is very much about me. So when I first started my business, I got hired to do a keynote presentation for a large sales organization. They brought me in to do some training, speak on their main stage for, and also do a breakout session for their team. And here's kind of what happened was they hired me to speak about some certain topics. They sent me, you know, kind of the overview of like what time of day I'll be speaking. And I will say that it wasn't very specific, the information that they sent. I now handle things very differently in these types of situations when people ask me to come and speak. But I was kind of in that place of, and I don't know if you can relate to this, but sometimes when you feel like you're kind of getting your feet under you, you almost don't want to ask questions because you don't want to seem unprofessional or seem like you don't know what to do. And I think that's where I was. I don't think I asked questions at the time because I didn't want to seem like I didn't really know what I was doing. And this is very early on in my business, like in the first maybe couple months of starting my business. So I just didn't want to seem like, oh, I don't know what I'm doing. I've never gotten paid like this to speak at this event. Now, what I charge them, when I think about what I charge them, was a ridiculously low amount of money. Like, honestly, I don't even do spotlight coaching sessions now, maybe a spotlight coaching session. I don't even do strategy sessions, like one-on-one 50-minute strategy session with somebody for the price that I charge this company. And they paid to fly me out. So they paid my expenses, put me up in this hotel. And we had this agreement that I was going to speak twice that day. And I was going to have a little table they asked me to set up to, you know, so people from the conference could come and ask me questions. They wanted me to have some books there to sell. So, you know, I did that. And I flew out, and there was no agenda given to me. So I knew what time they told me that I was supposed to speak. I texted the person when I got there, told her I was here. And she said, great, we're going to do a thing in the morning. Not sure if you need to be at it, but if you could come and show up like 15 minutes early before your speaking time, we'll get your presentation, you know, up on the screen and we'll be good to go. We're going to take a little break. So I show up in the main room and go to talk to the AV guy that they had hired about hooking up my presentation. Now, little side story. I come from an AV background. That was the majority of my career in the technology space of selling audiovisual equipment. And I'm very familiar with the technology. I'm also very familiar with AV guys who run these types of shows. And the first thing he did is, oh, you can't hook your Mac to it. It won't work. Yes, it will work. So I explained how to do it. Well, you know, that was going to require him to have to unplug a cable and plug a different cable in. Okay. I had my adapter with me. Like I was totally ready to go. But anyway, he kind of made a big deal about it and took a really long time to get it to work. Now, he kept saying like, oh, there's something wrong with your computer. I knew there wasn't anything wrong with my computer, but I was just trying to stay professional. And I was nervous. This was my first big like speaking gig. So it took extra time. It ended up delaying me getting up on stage and starting. But when I did get up on stage and gave my presentation, I will say the response from the people in the room, the salespeople in the room, and there were like 90 salespeople in the room, it was a hit. It was a big time hit. As a matter of fact, when I came off the stage, went out to the little table where they asked me to set up, I felt like I was like rushed with people, and people were fighting to like buy my books because I only brought like, I don't even remember, like 20 books or something, because my book was also brand new out. It was the first book I'd ever written, which is called 6-Word Lessons on Influencing with Grace. It's not really even a sales book. It's more of an NLP communication book. And people were like, that's my copy. That's, you know, and I'm trying to take orders and I'm trying to answer questions and people are trying to schedule times to like talk about hiring me. So it was like this bum rush of people. I ended up encouraging people to just go and buy the book off of Amazon. And then I went and did my other presentation like an hour later, and it was a big hit in the room. The feedback from the people in the room was like, we've never had a speaker like you. This information was awesome. So you're probably wondering, like, where's the failure come in? It's coming. So I left there on a high. I left that, you know, flew back home feeling really proud of myself and how it went, and having booked new clients from it. And I got home and I sent my invoice off to the company. Here's where the failure starts to come. And crickets. And so I followed up, just want to make sure you got this. Crickets. Okay. Waited a couple days, called the person, no response. Days. Sent another email with another attachment of the invoice, you know, asking them to remit payment. Crickets. And this went on for a couple weeks. And I was to the point where I was like, okay, what is going on? Like, is she okay? This person, like, I was kind of starting to get worried because she was so communicative about booking me. And then when I was asking for payment, nothing. So I finally crafted this message, which is something that I teach my clients to do today, of like, I'm really concerned. Are you okay? I've sent you a few messages. I haven't heard anything back. I just, one, want to make sure you're okay. Would you please let me know? So she did respond to that, let me know she was okay. And I was like, okay, so now we're in a communication. And so then I said, I wanted to make sure that you got my invoice and see if you have any questions. You know, that was the, I think I put on there, like they had 7 days to pay it. So it was way past that at this point. So I was like, so at this point, you know, it is a little past due. So I just wanted to ask, when can I expect payment? To which she then responded, Nikki, can I give you some feedback on how that went for us? So I was like, sure, because I'm thinking it's going to be really great feedback. It was not great feedback. I will say I felt like I got ripped apart in this response, letting me know how unprofessional they thought I was. Because their presentation, you know, because we got them off schedule, because my equipment wouldn't work, which, okay, not true, but yes, we did start late. So that threw off their schedule a little bit. Like we probably started 10 minutes late before I could get the AV guy to let me show him how to hook everything up properly. And then she just completely blasted me about what I wore on stage and how I looked unprofessional and how the CEO of the company was embarrassed that they had hired a keynote speaker dressed like me, which I will say, I don't know if you have these things in your life that are kind of, that you're extra sensitive about. Here's one of mine. I feel really vulnerable sharing this with you right now, but one of mine is I grew up pretty poor. And white trash. Like, I know I've shared that on the podcast before. Like, we were kind of considered white trash. And I was always really sensitive about the fact that, you know, we shopped at the most, like, the cheapest stores, didn't really ever have, like, the in fashion clothing. So I'm really, like, I've always been really sensitive about my clothing. Now, here's what I wore on stage. A pair of slacks, a blazer, and a colored like top underneath the blazer. Now, my hair was done. At the time, I really wasn't wearing any makeup, mostly because I didn't know how to put on makeup. I didn't grow up in a situation where I didn't have a mom that taught me how to put on makeup. I have a mom, but I didn't live with her for a lot of years of my life. And that's just not something she ever really taught me to do. So I didn't really know how to put on makeup. So I used to wear, I think, a little bit of eyeliner and a little bit of mascara. And that was all that I wore. And so she was saying how the CEO was like embarrassed that the way I was dressed on stage and that I just looked like sloppy. And because I will say the tank top or the top that was underneath my blazer did come down below the blazer. It wasn't tucked in. And what was the other thing? Oh, how many complaints they got from the people in the room that couldn't purchase my book because I didn't bring enough for everybody to buy one. And that was kind of her feedback. Nothing, by the way, mentioned about payment. So I took this in this moment when I read this email, like I'm sure my face was bright red because my face gets red when I get embarrassed. So I was like so embarrassed, so humiliated, and you know, instantly tears. Like I was just so, I didn't know what to do. And I thought about it for a couple minutes and I just was filled with so much shame that my instant response back to her was I discounted the speaking fee big time. I think I cut it in half or something. I can't actually remember, but I think it was in half. And if it wasn't in half, it was at least, it was a huge discount. And they were already paying me like really next to nothing, like less than $1,000. And so then I cut my fee and asked for them to pay, which then they took another, I don't even remember, 3 or 4 weeks to pay. I know it was a really long time for them to actually pay. And so I still to this day consider this one of my biggest failures. And I didn't seek any advice in the moment because I was so embarrassed. I didn't even want to tell anybody. I think eventually I talked it through with my husband and he was like, okay, so why would you discount your fee? You still delivered. You still did what they said. People are so happy. You booked a bunch of clients from it. You sold out all your books, plus made a bunch of sales on Amazon for your books. Like, what are you doing? But I just was filled with so much shame that I had this like knee-jerk reaction. So then, of course, give me a couple days of feeling like, you know, I felt about an inch tall. I started really kind of going, okay, Nikki, you got to get out of this. Like, you got to get out of this shame and this failure, and you got to figure out like what to do. So then I always revert back to my NLP training. And the question that I often ask, well, the question I ask myself and the question that I often give my clients to ask themselves when something doesn't go right or somebody has like a criticism for you in some way is to ask yourself, is this true? And so when I went back and read her email, each one of her little like things that she said about me and about what I did wrong, I had to ask myself, is this true? And get really honest with myself about where I could have done better. So I should have probably showed up at that like early morning thing just to like troubleshoot and hook my equipment up and make sure everything was working. Like, okay, I could have, you know, gotten up at, it was like 6:30 in the morning and been down there to do this thing for them. I probably could have brought more books with me. I'd really never sold that many books. So, you know, okay, so I'll know for next time. So yes, that was true. I should have brought more books. I could see where people were disappointed. And was I dressed unprofessionally? No, that wasn't true. However, could I have upped my game in my outfit choice? Yes, that could have been. Now, does that justify the response, the fact that they didn't pay in a timely fashion? No, that wasn't true. So when you think about how do you turn these into like business opportunities is you go, okay, so of the things that weren't true, what can I do to ensure that these types of things don't happen again? Well, I can ask better questions next time, which I do now. I can have them sign contract, which I do now. I can ask them, not even ask them, but tell them the only way I do this is you pay me before I speak. I expect payment up front now. And as a matter of fact, I don't even deliver content anymore to any company unless they have paid for it because that's my intellectual property. And once I give it away, it's so easy for them to decide what they think the value of it is, but I know the value of it. So I'm not willing to speak for companies anymore unless they pay in full. before I step on the stage. So these are the things where you can turn this stuff around. But to really get clear, like, is this true? Now, since then, I started to recognize, obviously, there were some things that I needed some support around. I had some, you know, issues about, obviously, the way I dress and feeling really insecure about the fact that I didn't know how to put on makeup and I didn't really wear makeup. You know, so I hired a stylist as soon as I could afford it. I hired a stylist. I still work with her to this day, Lisa Fisher from Lisa Fisher Styling. She's amazing. And Lisa taught me how to put on makeup, like something I didn't really know how to do. Now, I'm not suggesting if you're somebody who's like, I'm anti-makeup, that's fine. It brings confidence to me now. I feel more confident when I have some makeup on. I still don't feel like I wear a ton of makeup, but I at least now know how to put on some like blush and I, you know, can wear a little lipstick. I never even wore lipstick before I ever worked with Lisa because I didn't know how to pick a color. I didn't know how to do any of that stuff. Lisa now helps me pick out the colors of the outfits that I wear so that I show up and be the best version of myself, colors that complement my skin tone, my eye color, my lip color, all these things that I've had to learn from somebody. This is how you turn these into opportunities. And I don't know if I've ever shared this on the podcast, and I don't know if she'll be listening, but one of the women that hired me this last year said that she saw me. I was on a podcast, but had a video component to it. And she saw me and she was like, hey, here's somebody who seems really put together. You know, her hair's done, her makeup's on, she's got really beautiful jewelry. And this is what she said to me. And she was like, so that was why we reached out to you initially. That's why I went to your website to check you out, find out more about you, because I felt like you were really put together. So business opportunity, right? Like I get business now because I show up prepared. And also, I tend to bring my own equipment now when I go and speak because I know how to make it work. I know how to make it work. And I don't have to rely on an AV person who maybe is not as versed in AV and or doesn't really have any incentive to try to help me to get something to work, right? So these are all places where you can take from a failure and go, how can I turn this around? How can I make this work for me? Now, here's the other thing is I also raised my price. I've never, ever spoken for that kind of a fee again and wouldn't. As a matter of fact, now it would be thousands of dollars for me to go and speak at an event like this because there are people, they made money off of the things that I taught them for the company. They made a lot of money for the company off the things that I taught them. And I know that my stuff works. I know that people can implement it and make money off of it. So think about any time you have had some type of a failure or you have felt like, you know, whether you agree if this is a failure or not, but something that has felt like, I'm ashamed of that or that feels bad to me in some way. Ask yourself, what part of it is true? The parts that have some truth to them, okay, what can you do differently next time to ensure that you're more prepared? I often actually get told when I go and speak, people will say like, you're the most prepared speaker. Like we had your bio, we had your, you know, your links. I get this when I guest on podcasts too. People will be like, wow, we had all your stuff. Like we didn't have to ask you for anything because you just got it all. Now I pay somebody to do that, to deliver that kind of content to people too. But it's like, I want to show up. I hope that people always walk away and going like, she's professional, she's prepared. So that's how I'm going to say I turn this into a business opportunity. All right, here's another little story. I was looking to see if I had shared this before, and I wrote a blog post about this that's called When to Kick 'em to the Curb. Years ago, I wrote this blog post, and I was actually speaking at an event. And a woman came up to me and she had a sales question that she waited until it was just her and I. There were other people around initially asking me questions. She waited until it was just her and I to ask me this question. And I could tell that she was like really sincere in her question and what she wanted to ask me. So I was excited to hear her question. And what she had said to me was that she was at like a vendor event and she was selling her product at it, like a, had a table set up selling her product. So she had physical product. It was handmade items that she was selling. And she said that a woman approached her and asked her if she could give her some feedback on why she might be losing business. And the woman who was talking to me agreed to be open to the feedback. And what the woman then said to her is that she thought that she should know that people might not buy from her because she was overweight. Now, the woman that I was talking to, definitely a full-figured woman. And as she's explaining to me and sharing with me the way the woman delivered this, like I could feel my temperature rising. Like I was so outraged on her behalf. But at the same time, I could tell that she wasn't telling me this story like in any way to try to diminish the woman who gave her the feedback. Like she legitimately wanted me to tell her whether or not her weight was causing her to not be able to earn people's business. Now, I'm going to tell you my thought about this, whether you agree or not, that's okay. We can respectfully disagree if you disagree with what I'm about to say, but I'm going to say, and what I said to her is, well, first of all, because I wanted to be really thoughtful in my response. I didn't want to just dismiss it and say that's ridiculous or, you know, that's BS, which was like, I really had a lot of curse words in my mind about what I wanted to say about the way that this woman gave her feedback. But I just said to her, I said, you know, may I ask you a question before I give you my response? Which she said, yes. And I said, now the woman who gave you the feedback, what kind of business was she in? And specifically, did she make money by helping people lose weight? And it was like a light bulb went on over her head. She hadn't made the connection. And I was like, okay, so maybe you knew where I was going with this. Like you might not be surprised that the woman who was giving her this feedback about her being overweight made her money by teaching people how to lose weight. Now, nothing wrong with what she did for a living, how she approached my client and, or not, she wasn't even my client, just a woman in the room that I was speaking to, but how she approached her, I'm going to say bad business. I feel really strongly that is just bad business. If you have to shame people into hiring you, I feel the hairs on my arms standing up right now. It makes me so angry. I cannot stand the shaming of people to try to get them to hire you. I'm going to have to step away here and get off my soapbox because it makes me so angry. There's just no excuse for trying to make somebody feel small. And when I think back to my own story that I shared with you, when I look back at it now, and if somebody had come to me, if one of my clients had had this experience and came to me, like I would have said right away, is she trying to get a discount because they can't afford to pay this? Or what's going on here? Because she owes you money. Like they owe you money and they're now ripping you apart, you know, when you're asking for money, not like gave you the feedback right after the event. It's only when you ask for money that they're trying to rip you apart. Not okay. Same thing for this woman, you know, somebody who offered to give her some feedback as to why she might be losing people's business because it was her way to try to give her money. I don't like it. I don't agree with it. I actually had somebody do this. I wasn't going to tell the story. Now I'm just telling stories. I got asked to speak at another event and the woman who arranged for the speakers had said to me, she was like in a volunteer role. So her volunteer role was to like give all the logistics to the speaker. So we worked through all the logistics and she had said to me, now, one of the things that I do is I would like to schedule a time just to review results and give you any feedback that the people in the room have. So I thought that was part of their process. So I agreed to it. And so I went and spoke, had a really great experience, got really good feedback from the room, booked clients from it. And then her and I had a meeting. And so I thought she was going to tell me, like, we, you know, asked them for surveys. Here's what they had to say about you, because that happens sometimes. But actually what it was is she was somebody who trained speakers on how to be a better speaker. So I felt like it was a little misleading. And, you know, I think the way that she kind of started was like she thought she was gonna like get me to hire her. And so I started asking her some specifics about the things that she was critiquing. Like, did you experience this with me as a speaker? She had nothing negative to say about me speaking, which is nice. Like, not that I'm perfect, because I certainly am not, but she didn't have anything that she could help me on. And it just felt so shady. And then she was like, maybe we could trade. Like, you could help me with sales. And I was like, I don't think so. Like, first of all, I felt like you were misleading in the way you even approached this. And I didn't ask you for your feedback about me speaking. I asked for feedback from the room of how it went for everybody. Yes, you're one person in the room. Okay, go ahead and give me your opinion, but that doesn't mean I'm going to hire you. So, all right. Turning failures into business opportunities. Decide how much access you're going to give people to you. Whose feedback are you going to take? And is there any kind of underlying, Is there any kind of underlying motive that the person has that's giving you feedback? And if there is, maybe you shouldn't be taking feedback from them, or you got to take it with a grain of salt. So turning failures into feedback. I hope the story helps about my own failure. And it felt weird to like be asked this question and remember this story and then think, okay, well, maybe I will share this on the podcast, because things don't always go well. I think sometimes people have impressions of like everything goes well for certain people. It definitely doesn't for me. I also struggle with a lot of, you know, self-confidence issues in a lot of areas. I try to minimize those. And I also try to set myself up for success so that when there is a failure, like there was in the payment situation, that I don't allow for that to happen again. So I hope that's what you'll take away from this episode, is really changing some of your structures and processes when something doesn't go well to protect yourself. Now, I'm not a big fan of making like some crazy, you know, putting up some huge barrier for people to hire you or pay you money because you had one bad experience, or taking one negative feedback from somebody and making a whole big change to your business model. Unless it's going to protect you, unless it's going to give you some confidence when you go into the next opportunity, like you're going to get paid up front. I am a fan of that. All right. So I hope this was helpful. Now, as we are getting close to the end of 2021, the 2021 for me is the year of the question. So here's the question that I want you to maybe put in your back pocket and have available, so that when you find yourself in situations that you ask yourself, I've already given this question, but ask yourself this, is it true? Whatever it is it true? If a customer is saying something good to you, maybe ask yourself, is it true? If a customer is saying something bad to you, you're getting some kind of criticism, is it true? And maybe you might even add a second question on here, which is there any part of it that I agree with? And if so, how best should I respond? I did learn in my moment that I should have taken some time, and I should have went and sought advice, sought counsel from people who I really admire and who maybe have been in similar type situations, because I probably wouldn't have discounted my price. I would have said, thank you for the feedback. When can I expect payment? Now, this company has never offered to hire me again, but I'll tell you what, if they did, I would say no. Like they left, maybe I left a bad taste in their mouth, but man, they left a bad taste in mine too, in the way that they treated me. So again, you get to decide that. All right. So last little thing here. If you want some help in boosting your confidence around sales and really honing your selling skills, I'm going to invite you to join the Sales Maven Society. This is my monthly membership program. This is where you and I come together. You bring questions, you bring your situations and your concerns, and I'm going to provide answers and guidance to really boost your confidence and your skill set around sales conversations. You can join the Sales Maven Society right now by going to www.salesmavensociety.com. It's $147 a month. And let me tell you, it is worth it. You get 2 live coaching calls with me a month in a group. You get access to me in a group daily. My group is often surprised at how interactive I am in there and how many questions that I field and give feedback on. And you also get access to my training content as well, plus some other goodies. So if you would like to join the Sales Maven Society, I'm going to give you a special coupon code to try it out for your first month. See if it's the place for you. If you enter the coupon code 47TRIAL, when you go to salesmavensociety.com, enter 47TRIAL, it'll take $100 off your first month of membership, and we would love to have you with us. Thank you so much for listening. And hey, if you have a story for me of a failure and something that you turned into a business opportunity, like what you learned from it and how you now apply it in your business, I would love to hear from you. Please reach out. You can reach me on social media. I tend to hang out on Instagram. I love direct messages from people. And email me, Nikki@yoursalesmaven.com. And you can also find me on LinkedIn. Thank you so much for listening. Have a great rest of your day.
Thanks for listening to Sales Maven. Visit us online at yoursalesmaven.com/maven for more resources to boost your confidence and skills.